Balya story is the story which must be told, because that's the saga of our independence. Balya is a small town on the border of UP and Bihar. During the rain sometime, it became free because Ganga was in spate and Son River was in spate. So these 7 days, these people ruled themselves. And the atrocities which the British committed when they came back are indescribable. They hung them on the tree and so on. So there was a commissioner who used to call Butcher of Balya. So, don't tell me that it's a benevolent trip we have.
Extracts from the diary of E. Waddell, Superintendent of Police, Balya, November 9th and 10th, 1942. Visited dispensary and found 29 wounded had been there and had cleared off a day before. Took extensive punitive action in two villages. Fought till 1 a.m., still dark. Killed at least 20 and wounded 30 to 40.
What type of atrocities they committed? Because they wanted the native to learn the lesson that you dare not revolt, you will not revolt, otherwise this will be your fate.
It is still a matter of local pride in Balya that before the flag fell, another grabbed and supported that symbol of national struggle. 11 men were killed, one after another, by soldiers of the Crown.
I was obsessed by the idea to write on Balya. Because of not only one Balya, so many Balyas in the country, we got independence.
My work as a journalist sent me to different parts of the country. This was the first time I truly experienced India. The lovely texture of fields, the sturdy strands of faith, the diversity of local cultures, the modest huts of hardy farmers. I saw dams, factories, and laboratories rising in the wilderness. The widespread poverty, illiteracy, and disease I witnessed left an indelible impression upon me.
In my life, I had two traumatic experiences as I look back. One was this partition, the other was the emergency. Partition, I had to leave my house, everything. And when you cross the border, you were penniless, you didn't have anything at all. There came a stage in our relations that this, when the Pakistan demand was raised, After that, I could see some kind of hesitation coming. Now they had divided the kitchens. Hindu kitchen, Muslim kitchen. It didn't make sense. But then, yeah, that was a sequence of things because you had started having the Muslims and Hindus, two nations. We didn't want to leave our house in Sialkot city. So there were very decent people who had come from Jalandhar, some Muslim. They said, we appreciate you, but we have left everything, so you would have to. They didn't force us anything.
I did not want to leave Sialkot. This was my home. Why could not I, a Hindu, live in the Islamic state of Pakistan? Where would we go if we were to uproot ourselves? Our spiritual guardian was here. Not a superstition, but our faith that the grave in our back garden was that of a peer who protected us. How could we leave the peer? The grave was our refuge. Ma, we three brothers and a sister bowed before the peer and lit a lamp. It was our temple.
I met Jinnah. So I remember I asked him two questions which proved to be very prophetic. So what would happen when the British leave? Because we will be jumping at each other's throat, so much hatred. He said, young man, we will be the best of friends. Don't you know Germany and France, for years they fought wars among the best of friends. 1 million people were killed in this whole forced migration. I think again and again that maybe Jinnah was wanting differently, but he was very bad. So tell me, why was there partition?
ਅੱਜ ਆਖਾਂ ਵਾਰਿਸ ਸ਼ਾਹ ਨੂੰ ਕਿ ਤੂੰ ਕਬਰਾਂ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਬੋਲ ਤੇ ਅੱਜ ਕਿਤਾਬੇ ਇਸ਼ਕ ਦਾ ਕੋਈ ਅਗਲਾ ਵਰਕਾ ਫੋਲ ਇੱਕ ਰੋਈ ਸੀ ਧੀ ਪੰਜਾਬ ਦੀ ਤੂੰ ਲਿਖ ਲਿਖ ਮਾਰੇ ਵਹਿਣ ਅੱਜ ਲੱਖਾਂ ਧੀਆਂ ਰੋਂਦੀਆਂ ਤੈਨੂੰ ਵਾਰਿਸ ਸ਼ਾਹ ਨੂੰ ਕਹਿਣ वे दर्दमंदा दे दर्दिया उठ तक अपना पंजाब अज बेले लाशां विछिया ते लहू दी भरी चराब इस जरखे जमीन दे लू लू फुटिया जहर गिठ गिठ चढ़िया लालिया फुट फुट चढ़िया कैर अज आखां वाले शानू ਕਿ ਤੂੰ ਕਬਰਾਂ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਬੋਲ ਤੇ ਅੱਜ ਕਿਤਾਬੇ ਇਸ਼ਕ ਦਾ ਕੋਈ ਅਗਲਾ ਵਰਕਾ ਫੋਲ
ਕਾਇਦ ਆਜ਼ਮ ਮੁਹੰਮਦ ਅਲੀ ਜਾਹ ਵਾਸ ਫਾਊਂਡਰ ਆਫ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਹੀ ਵੁੱਡ ਸੇ that religion was the basis of nationality. And we would argue, okay, how come? And Gandhi very rightly said, okay, all right, today I embrace Islam, I become a different nation. Jinnah had no answer to that, but that was true. For centuries, we lived together, Hindus and Muslims. Midna, Chulna, Eid, Diwali, all together. So British started dividing us. This line or a border, whatever you want to say, I think that was really drawn on the hearts of the people. Then, of course, now, two different people or two different nations, whatever you want to.
वतन अब भी वही है पर नहीं है मुल्क अब मेरा वहां जाना हो अब तो दो दो सरकारों के दसियों दफ्तरों से शक्ल पर लगवा के मोहरें ख्वाब साबित करने पड़ते हैं
वो जो हम डिस्पाइट माय लेफ्टिस्ट लीनिंग्स आई हैव कम टू बिलीव दैट देयर इज अ पावर बियॉन्ड I am neither an atheist nor an agnostic. I am convinced that there is something called destiny, which makes you choose a particular path from the many before you. I studied law, but settled on journalism. Perhaps my faith springs from something I read years ago. वक्त से पहले नहीं मुकद्दर से ज्यादा नहीं
बट व्हेन आई रीच अमृतसर बॉर्डर आई रियलाइज के नो पेनीलेस हाउ डू यू स्टार्ट अगेन बिकॉज उस वक्त तक मैं LLB पढ़ चुका था जामा मस्जिद में मैं जाया करता था नॉन वेजिटेरियन फूड सस्ता तो एक आदमी मुझे हर दफा पहुंचे अरे यार तुम काम वाम नहीं करते मैंने कहा जी मैं तो बी ऑनर्स LLB हूँ तो कोई नौकरी नहीं मिलती मैं किसी मिलती है लेकिन क्लर्क ही नहीं करूँगा उर्दू जानते हो मैं कहती हूँ उर्दू फारसी का तो मैं ग्रेजुएट हूँ कहते यहाँ पे एक मुसलमान मालिक है यासीन उसको एक हिंदू की जरूरत है जो कि वो जानता हो इन दैट पेपर आई रिकॉल महात्मा गांधीज असैसिनेशन आई कवर्ड सो आई सॉ ऑन द टिकर गांधी शॉट दैट वाज ऑल सो आई रश By that time, I went to Birla House. He was dead. So that I recall that was my first major event I covered. जब कश्ती साबत सालम थी साहिल की तमन्ना किसको थी अब ऐसी शिकस्ता कश्ती पे साहिल की तमन्ना कौन करे गांधी जी के प्रार्थना में पढ़ा जाता था ईश्वर अल्लाह तेरे नाम सबको सन्मति देव भगवान तो वो हमारा कॉन्सेप्ट ही शुरू से रहा आई एम द शेपर्ड एंड यू आर माई फ्लॉक और सब लोग वहीं जाएंगे और वहीं से आए
द इंटायर कल्चरल फैब्रिक दैट हिंदूज मुस्लिम्स एंड सिक्स हैड शेयर्ड फॉर सेंचुरीज वॉज इन टैटर्स ऑल आई नो इज दैट आई टू हैव क्राइड टू माई सेल्फ एट नाइट and felt a personal sense of helplessness that comes from the absence of a foundation on which to build.
There was a concern about the people of the subcontinent, and that pain of the partition always gets reflected in your writing. And lately, last few years I have seen, you have taken interest in the human rights, particularly in India. What are your concerns at the present time?
Well, I think human rights cannot be practiced unless people have something to eat, have there in the something in stomach. So my concern is that if we are able to abolish poverty or lessen it, to that extent we have really helped in the rights of human beings. ...33% of our population go to bed without meal. Once I asked Shastriji, I said, why is there no revolution in this country? And I gave him an example of famine in Bengal. People will die of starvation, but not a pebble was thrown. We recognize them as human beings, and that concern that, look here, they must eat. My concern has been that human rights today are really emanating from the status of a person, and if he has something to live, to eat, and then on to function. See, where I used to work on jam also, there at that time, in that area, very famous Urdu poet Hasrat Mohani, who had already also participated in the national struggle, he used to live. Maine utko apni ka biyaz di, ye durst kar dijiye, dekha, kehta beta, ye tukbazi hai, koi shayari nahi hai. ये मैं तुम्हारी नसीहत देता हूँ कि ये छोड़ दो. उसके बाद मैंने कभी शेर नहीं लिखा कोई. और दूसरी जो है, मैं जो सलाह देता हूँ कि उर्दू जर्नलिज्म का कुछ फ्यूचर मुझे हिंदुस्तान में नहीं लगता, तुम अंग्रेज़ी की तरफ चलो जाए. सो आई रिज़ाइन एंड वेंट टू अमेरिका एंड देन आई से अर्न डिग्री इन जर्नलिज्म. व्हेन आई वाज नाउ ऑलमोस्ट क्लियरिंग माय डिग्री, I was short, I still remember, $140. So from where do you get it? So Norman Cousins, who was editor of a paper called, at that time, Saturday Review. And I was a very well-respected editor and a writer, very good writer. He had come to India and I was his interpreter in this refugee camps, etc., because he wanted to write on that. I wrote to him the following day or the day after, a check of that amount came. So I, in fact, later when I was going to returning to India at New York, I went to his office and thanked him personally.
चमन की सिमत पे कर नजर, समा तो देख बेखबर, समा तो देख.
It appeared to be an impossible task to defeat hunger on the scale that it was prevalent in the country. Even so, I had an unshaken faith that we would one day overcome our problem of poverty and parochialism.
राग छेड़ मो तेरे बा, असर सदाए साज का
I have always believed that optimism is a moral duty.
I joined 54.
Okay.
Those were the days when whatever one wrote, features, etc., newspaper used to pick it up. One was very pleased that you saw that not only Times of India, Hindustan Times, Express, all used to have the feature which you have written. I was trying to convey to India and abroad that we are really looking after the backward, are those who had this stigma of untouchability. I said, okay, every time we say slums, what are these slums? How do the people live?
How interesting.
So I went and this outside Bombay, there's a big slum. There they thought, okay, my God, he's a government agent or spy. But I was able to do much better in Delhi. Delhi, there was a communal riot at Kishanganj Mahalla. And Kishanganj Mahalla had a worker working in the Statesman. Then I was editor. So I told him, I said, I would like to experience what people will go through. So I said, can I stay in your house? I went and stayed in his house. At midnight or even 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, police would come, just go around the house. So when I came back, I wrote about it in the Statesman article. This is how the police behaves. So I wanted these persons, they were in the slum, to get outside, and I found a place also.
So there, you would say there was a kind of a commitment and a humanism in not only just reporting, but also getting involved in what was happening around you.
And
was that with all journalists at that time?
No, I wouldn't say that from all, but maybe because I had suffered. I had come from Sialkot city, walking, mm-hmm. and partition, and came to Amritsar. So I had seen the suffering I had gone through.
Without doubt, the meek had inherited the earth. Poverty had taught Prime Minister Shastri humility. And people found this an endearing trait. Shastri's simplicity was his forte. I thought I would help him to highlight that image through my dispatches for UNI.
See, India was importing food grains and spending a lot of foreign exchange. So Shastri gave a slogan, "Miss a meal." And very many people followed that, Miss Amir. China has attacked us in 1962. One speech he made was, look here, these are soldiers, don't have even shoes. And we have been defeated because we didn't have weapons. So I was so much impressed myself that I gave my wedding ring there and then.
That time he was able to inspire
the people and also practice himself. So when we are coming to the present time, this austerity would mean filling the gap between the rich and the poor. It's right. Increasing. We were very near our national movement. Mm-hmm. So people who had gone through the fire were still available, some, very few. And what they had learned from Gandhiji, austerity, what they had really, his food habits, his living, etc. So these people practiced. And when the first time Congress ministers took oath, Gandhiji said only 500 rupees. See, the whole national struggle of ours was, when we get independence, then we are going to create an egalitarian society. Now, nobody even talks about it. I'm saying, yes, they talk about the poor, etc. That's all, it's a slogan.
Dedicated to the common man, who has patiently waited for the fruits of peaceful changes in the country. To the people of India, the only ones who could and did. To my wife, Bharti, who shares the glory but not the blame. Dedicated to a Gurgaon tea shop wala, who struck me as having a more realistic and down-to-earth approach to Indian problems than leaders in Delhi.
Aaj ke naam aur aaj ke gham ke naam. Aaj ka gham ki hai zindagi ke bhare gulsitan se khafa. Kalarkon ki afsurda jano ke naam. Kirm khurda dilo aur zabano ke naam. पोस्टमैनों के नाम, तांगे वालों के नाम, रेल बानों के नाम, कारखानों के भूखे जियालों के नाम, पढ़ने वालों के नाम, वो जो आसा बे तबलो अलम के दरों पर किताब और कलम का तकाजा लिए हाथ फैलाए पहुंचे, मगर लौट कर घर ना आए। उन असीरों के नाम जिनके सीनों में फरदा के शब्ताब गौहर, जेल खानों की शोरीदा रातों की सरसर में जल जल के अंजुम नुमा हो गए हैं।
दुख दर्द सईयों किनु फूल दसा दुख दर्द सईयों मेरा रोग ताला इलाज दिसे कर काट साई कनु छुटे मैं थो क्यों सवाल जवाब दिसे
My mother used to be so brave, she would never sort of cry before anybody during that time, you know, this one didn't know most of the time you were in jail. So I think maybe we sisters have inherited that thing. It became part of our life that, you know, my father going to jail and, you know, my mother shifting to the grandparents and the thing. In spite of everything, you know, I think what gave me the strength was that my mother at the age of my father, 85, can bear it. Why can't I also be like her? But difficult times. Children were small and they needed their father. And we didn't know when he will be released, how he is doing. She's not used to this kind of life. We were allowed to see him. They said only two people. Then Sudhir had also come that time. And so we requested that let Sudhir also join us in meeting. But they didn't. So then Rajiv didn't meet him because he had already met him first time. And then he would sort of was trying to see from the wall. I think she was no less than the Britishers who, so even after so many years, you know, you keep on thinking what would have happened. Suffering more, I think, than I was suffering, because I was at least with the family. He was alone. But he's a brave person. Ramnath ji told me that, you know, we have already filed a case and Tharkunde is going to look after. And when the Kuldeep's case was to be discussed, I got a call from Soli from Bombay. So he said, Bhati, I'm coming to do Kuldeep's case. I said, Soli, I can't afford your fee. He said, who's asking you about the fee? I'm not only going to do your case, but even your father's case I'm doing. I've told Rajinder I'm coming. I'm taking up both the cases.
Well, one reason for taking it up was it was an instance of misuse of MISA. Clearly an illegal order passed against him. And I was all the time really concerned about the way freedom of expression and people who so-called independent people were put behind bars under MISA, for which you give no reasons, nothing. So I thought it was a good case. And I knew Kuldeep before as the editor in The Statesman. As to like his writings, enjoy what he said. So I offered. And what's more, not only Kuldeep, his father-in-law, Bhimsen Sacha, he was put behind bars. That's one of the worst cases of misuse of MISA that I've come across.
This was the first time I had actually met him. One recollection I have is that the Statesman those days used to be a more widely read paper. And your column used to appear as the editor. And of course, the next that I came across him was The Emergency. You see, I was detained on the very first day. In fact, on the 26th of June, 1975, I escaped arrest at night. In the morning, we organized a protest and landed up in jail, along with one or two other people. So it was a great relief. Now you were with others also. So when we asked them as to why they were moving us back in Ambala, they said his father-in-law had also been arrested, Mr. Bhimsen Sacha. And he, along with one or two other people, had to be kept in that other ward. So I benefited from that by being brought back to my parent ward.
Because after all, MISA can be employed. There are certain conditions under which it can be utilized, it can be applied. They were absolutely missing in the case of Kuldeep Nahar and in the case of Bhimsen Sacha. I think it was one of the most preposterous cases that the dignified letter of protest was regarded as those people being a danger to public order.
But what happened thereafter was that they went in for the overkill. And the overkill was that they started, once they would arrest a person, before putting him under MISA, they would also register cases. It was a standard FIR, I am going to overthrow the establishment of India. So everybody had 2, 3, 4 cases against him. I had 7 cases against me. So at midnight, when the jail is closed, after the sunset, nobody can enter the jail. I think the district magistrate came to meet him.
He met me and
he told him that you are being released. And they released him tactically, not as an act of favor, so that at 10 o'clock they can tell the court, don't pass the judgment because he has already been released. That was their strategy.
Yes.
I think one great advantage historically which the emergency has left behind is nobody will ever dare impose it again. Technology will not now allow any form of censorship. People will blog from all over the world and put it on YouTube and Facebook. World also does not accept dictatorships now.
Express represents anti-establishment. It must be said to the credit of Ramnath Goenka. He gave us free hand, and I really ran the paper the way we wanted. Indira Gandhi gave us a compliment later. She said, one paper which destroyed me.
People were unaware of what the emergency signified. Dazed and confused, they realized that the democratic system they had faith in for nearly 30 years had been derailed, fundamental rights suspended, and judicial powers curtailed. I wrote to Mrs. Gandhi, "Madam, if the press were to publish only official statements, who will point out lapses, deficiencies, or errors?" JP believed that the time had come to awaken the people to the values and principles that were being destroyed. The protest began as a gentle breeze and soon developed into a storm.
In those days, the editors lived in the ivory towers. You were the exception.
Because essentially, I had come from reporting, and till the end, I reported this. Lifting of the emergency was my scoop.
I have advised the president to dissolve the present Lok Sabha and order fresh elections. This he has accepted.
You know, when they say the DNA of an 82-year-old institution, it is built by people like him, you know, editors, who have left very, very large shoes in which we hope to step in and do our work. I think what he tells us, the legacy that he has left in the newsroom, is the fact that you have to work for a story.
The Ramnath Goenka Foundation is pleased to honor Kuldeep Nair, who symbolized journalism's fight against the emergency, who, as editor,
Kuldeep Nair's service, journalism is something that will be there until the last day. You have to stand up to get the story, and you have to be the person in the room who says the emperor is naked.
Ab ishtiya ke arz-e tamanna nahi raha, ab har koi arz-e tamanna liye hue. Meri bhi zindagi hai ki marna pada mujhe. Ek aur zindagi ki aazu liye hue.
That was the time when everybody shunned us. Nobody would come close to us. The circumstances were like this. So we were not allowed to go and meet him in the jail. Only two people could meet him once a month. So my mother used to go and my uncle used to go. Rajiv at that time was in college. A friend of mine who just completed law. So he acted as his lawyer and I was allowed to accompany him as his assistant.
Many people still, when they meet me and realize that I'm my father's son and they have a great sense of respect and regard both for him and for me.
Oh, manu, yaad hai ki na Kuldeep nu vi te Raju nu minnu nu vi ni Raju nu bada shock hunda si barish hoye na pule bana to unna din hi badi barish hoyi te main Raju nu kya main keh Raju tere liye pule banwa du usse nahi mama jab daddy aayenge na phir khayenge.
का बहुत शौक था उर्दू का एंड मुझे बहुत याद है इससे तो वो बड़ा और फिर उसने अपना भी लिखा हुआ था मुझे सुनाया करता था. अब पॉलिटिकल तो कहाँ आते होंगे?
पॉलिटिकल सर अब आते हैं क्रिमिनल केस में.
हाँ, वो नॉट फॉर पॉलिटिक्स.
People who really I admire at that time, R. Ramnath Goenka ji, he was such a support that, you know, the day he was, Kuldeep was arrested, so he rang me up. Tum ghar mein ho? Main kaha, haan ji. To main aa raha hu. And within half an hour, he was here. And he said, I've told my office to look after you. Everything will be here. The car would be with you. You will get the money. देखो नैयर साहब को महीने में एक दो दफ़ा मिठाई भिजवा दिया करना इन द जेल. He had a very tough time in the jail because he was not used to it, but then my father was used to it because we grew up going to jail every day, every time I used to ask him, how was it? Theek tha? First time we were allowed to go to meet him in the jail. And Rajiv was there, and since morning he was collecting things. Daddy likes Chinese food, then ice cream, then we put it in the thermos. And when we went there, and then the jailer said, no, you can't eat this food. I said, aap bhi khaiye, ye bhi khate hai. And then Kuldeep was eating, and you know, he didn't know what he was eating. He was just gulping it down. He wanted to know more what is happening to the family, or to him, or to his friends and others. Very tough time. And then the next day, my father was arrested. My father was always saying that, you know, beta apna ek ghar hona chahiye. I remember when I was to build a house, the Kuldeep was very much against it. Nahi ghar kya karna hai, I said, I need a house. So Kuldeep said, I'm not going to do anything. So I started it. Everything has been arranged by the insurance company. Somehow he's not one of those who want to sort of think long as far as the domestic problems are concerned. He's more concerned about his work. So he never thought that this is a necessity. But they never sort of believed in the property. I don't know why. His father also, mother also.
After independence, we were all fired with that kind of national struggle. I was in the express, and the owner, Ramnath Goenka, told me, he said, Kuldeep, I want to make up with Mrs. Gandhi. And so I have to do certain things. So I gave him writing resignation. But you see, after that, I did not get any job in any newspaper of that. So I started my syndicate column, and I have been doing that now for so many years. 81, I started soon after she came back, and so.
Syndication, it is he who started. Later on came Khushwant Singh, and others are syndicating. There's no. And then he was writing books also. So he's the most well-known Indian journalist in the subcontinent. There's no doubt about it.
Then he said, let's try this. I had to go to Western Court. There they had that office where they would send it to the different states.
The post offices was there, no?
So, I would run. We started really having it on Wednesday from the very beginning, because they wanted it at 8 in the morning. We feel very happy, you know, many people, they say, you know, we have grown up with your articles.
I was very particular, as Pamela, that India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, she should be a sort of common market. I try my, that is, that this area should become a common market like Europe, and the borders should be soft, and we could go back and forth. That's the theme I always develop in my column.
I remember that I crossed this border in 1947, August. I was in a caravan, and this came, just this place, which is no man land. Our caravan stopped, and their caravan stopped. And both of us felt that we have been broken on the rack of history. And both of us had left behind our home, hearts, hopes, and we want to meet again.
इबादतों का जिक्र है, निजात की भी फिक्र है, जुनून है शबाब का, ख्याल है अजाब का, मगर सुनो तो शेख जी, अजीब शय है आप भी, निगार हाय फितनगर, कोई इधर कोई उधर, उभारते हैं ऐश पर।
भाई भाई
पाकिस्तान हिंदी,
भाई 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 भाई,
सुना है लोग उसे आंख भर के देखते हैं, सो उसके शहर में कुछ दिन ठहर के देखते हैं। सुना है दर्द की गाहक है चश्मेनाज उसकी, सो हम भी उसकी गली से गुजर के देखते हैं।
See, I went to Lahore. I had to interview Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto. He was in Islamabad. So there was no flight that evening for Islamabad. So I had to stay in Lahore. And so those people said, what can we do for you? I said, is it possible to meet Noor Jahan? I asked Noor Jahan, the singer, I said, how many records you must have got here? She said, Nayyar sahab, na gunahon ka shamar hai aur na hi ghazlon ka. She said, I can't count how many sins I have committed, nor I can count how many ghazals I have sung. And then she added, पहला अल्लाह मियाँ माफ़ कर देगा और दूसरा आप लोग माफ़ कर देंगे। When you say के how many loves, I don't know how many. They are not loves, right? They are just fascination. Love is only one love, I think. The first love.
In the city of Ghalib, it has become rare to hear chaste Urdu. But it is my first love, and I have stuck to it faithfully. My mother and I corresponded in Urdu. Born on the outskirts of Delhi, it represents the Ganga Jamuna culture, our secular ethos.
Urdu hai mera naam. मैं खुसरो की पहेली, मैं मीर की हमराज हूं, गालिब की सहेली। गालिब ने बुलंदी का सफर मुझको सिखाया, हाली ने मुरव्वत का सबक याद दिलाया, इकबाल ने आईना हक मुझको दिखाया, मोमिन ने सजाई मेरी ख्वाबों की हवेली। उर्दू है मेरा नाम, मैं खुसरो की पहेली।
My first visit to London was in 1952. I recalled how, while clamoring for India's independence as a schoolboy in Sialkot, I had received cane lashings from an English policeman. All those feelings of hurt and humiliation welled up within me again. A slave never overcomes the memory of wasted years. Now it was different. This time, a strange feeling of ecstasy and triumph enveloped me. I was Free India's representative. The British have a strange smoldering attachment to India, which the passage of time has not extinguished. the Raj has a 10-mile-long morgue at the India Office library. Everything about British rule and our struggle for independence lies here.
At this British Museum, Victoria Museum, in our history, I mean, say whatever is our history, past, Mughal and the thing, everything is there in the basement there. So they opened this Nehru Museum with our expense.
Yes.
So I asked the curator, how much you have in the basement? She said, we have shown you only 10%. That means, my God. So I then wrote to them that we will take to India, ensure it, and we shall give it back to you. We cannot forget.
Books, documents, photographs, posters, paintings, essentially a heritage which belongs to our subcontinent.
In the profession, it started now paid news. And people still believe in our country that what is written is correct. It's like the Bible. So now the industrial houses write in such a way that where you sell our name or our goods, etc., they pay you. The best of the newspapers now buy this thing. All right, you want on the front page, you want two-column headline or three-column headline, what do you want to be said? And it is written in the news style which people read, but it is mostly propaganda. Or what they are pushing, the line. If you have a law, then this would fetter the freedom of the press. After all, executive passes the law, executive have some motive, etc. So that wouldn't work. Peers must judge. That is the reason what press council came into being. If information is contaminated, the response is bound to be. Our forefathers were very particular, the freedom of the press must stay. You wouldn't take any instruction from the proprietor. I mean, so you would take instruction from the editor. That's all right, this is a prerogative. You wouldn't, but now the main person is the proprietor. I mean, say they are running a shop or a business, and proprietor, whatever he wants, has it. So that way, journalism here is, I would say, that classical type of journalism is not there. I am really thinking, and I have, that you sell this South Asian news service, SANS. And
SANS.
SANS. I just can name also SANS. And you have contribute, or at least who can buy it, Bangladesh journalists, Bangladesh newspapers, Pakistan newspapers, Sri Lanka newspapers, so all this. And moreover, in also, you Middle East, it would sell a lot.
Of course, your role is mentoring. Of the amount of women, you were sort of had to fight the system to get them in?
In fact, when I was a resident editor in Statesman, I was the one who introduced a woman reporter.
First one.
No other paper had it. See, I thought they have more objectivity than men. And also, more gutsy, no doubt about it, no doubt.
Why is that a woman, regardless of how good she was, never became editor-in-chief? Because you people stopped her somewhere.
I think not as the proprietor ultimately count.
Yeah.
And it's still male world.
Because you won't find enough women going into political reportage.
Huh.
And then when they do,
correct,
there is a stop in the career.
injustice still hurts me as it did 70 years ago. My instincts from a very early age have been to recognize people who suffered marginalization. The plight of others has touched me so deeply that I've sometimes made their sufferings mine. Looking back, it now seems obvious that I was destined to embrace the world of journalism.
अभी तो मैं जवान हूँ।